So much so that, you know, we are kind of caught up between trying to speak of Gandhi. The previous generation would always say Gandhi ji. It was not okay to say Gandhi alone. And, you know, some of us were caught, should we say Gandhi or Gandhi ji? But the main point is that I got into reading the collected works of Gandhi accidentally. I was doing some work on the craft sector and the Khadi movement. And what was interesting to me was the extensive discussions that I found in his writings. Later we discovered that he was one of the most documented persons in the history. Very open about any aspect of one's life. And also the fact that there's so many dimensions and facets of Gandhi's work which haven't quite, you know, reached out to many of us. For example, I was interested in science policy and science and innovation policy. And I was trying to see what was Gandhi's views on science. And the typical starting point would often be, look at Gandhi's writings on Hind Swaraj, and then you would tend to try and say he's reactionary, he's anti-machine, and so on. But there was another register which we tend to ignore a lot, is his conversations with co-workers. And if you read his conversations with co-workers, he often refers to a different understanding of science. And that's what got me excited about it. So he asks his co-workers to be more scientific. He asks them to learn from the examples from the West and so on. So it's a slightly different kind of dialogue. And one had noticed over a period of time that Gandhi's views on political philosophy was explicated a lot, but his views on science and today innovation and so on wasn't quite explored as much. So my point was essentially to start off with this notions of, you know, Gandhi's contributions and relevance is largely one as a personality and someone who's extremely open. You can be extremely critical about Gandhi and not get into any sedition charges or be behind bars at any point in time today, which you can't say with most of the other leaders in the country. There's a personal touch to it. One can dialogue with Gandhi the way you even see in the film that of the Munna Bhai series. And the fact that there are certain dimensions and ideas that haven't been explored enough. The second thing I found was that there hasn't been enough studies on Gandhi's institutions. And I accidentally again discovered his notion of the ashram as a scientific and prayerful experiment. It was not conceived as a typical ashram. And through the practice of constructive work, many stereotypes were broken. For example, more men spun in the ashram than women. And that was kind of to set up, it was more seen as a laboratory where experiments in cotton growing and other things happened. And this idea of institutions is something that's relatively unexplored. And I think today when we look at a failure of institutions, I think it's important to try and understand what the conceptions of those institutions were. And the third part is to do with the idea of innovation. And what we do find is the views of Gandhi were dynamic and responding constantly to situations. So sometimes there's a danger of trying to freeze his thoughts by looking only at a document written in 1909. And not combining it with, say, 39 years of practice. The final point I'd like to make is that very often we get stuck with the historical Gandhi. And what was fascinating for me, that even after Gandhi's death, some of his ideas were taken much further by, you know, people like Krishnadas Gandhi and others at the Khadi Gramodyog Prayog Samiti. And I found this fascinating facet that a technical journal in Hindi ran for 18 years and very few people were aware of it. So this idea that you can pick up the idea, you don't have to relate only to the historical Gandhi and try and experiment it in very many ways. And I think many people have actually explored this much further in their lives without necessarily being wearing a white khadi kurta or, you know, quoting Ram Naam every time. So that's broadly why I think that Gandhi continues to be relevant today.
Well, thank you so much, sir. I'd just like to, you know, for the youth, especially over here, when you look at the audience that is there over here also, it's nice to see a younger generation right at the back over there, but they're there. I'll give you a very interesting thought about Gandhi, which might excite you a little bit. You know, Gandhi was a great strategist. And the example I have for you is something that we just came across. You know, we talk about the salt march. The Salt March was 241 miles from Sabarmati Ashram to Dandi. And Gandhiji decided to do that in 24 days. I mean, often we ask why 24 days. And if you divide it, it's 10 miles a day. And if you read his autobiography, you will know that when he was in London, he used to walk 10 miles a day. He decided to stop at 48 villages. Why 48 villages? Being Gandhi, I'm sure it was 24 for lunch and 24 for dinner. He had 78 people start with him from Sabarmati. He had over 100,000 when he reached Dandi. And the whole of India was breaking the salt law. 1,300 newspapers all over the world carried the story. I mean, I personally have a Cairo newspaper in Arabic with him on the front page. And this is without Twitter, without Facebook. So you have to understand that how relevant he can be today if he could achieve that kind of communication strategy in that time. Well, so your remarks.
You made a very important point when you say that Gandhi should not be frozen either in his time or in a particular text that he may have written. And the most crucial text would be the Hind Swaraj in the context of Gandhi's relevance. Now, people who were close to Gandhi, people like Jawaharlal Nehru towards the end, and people like Gopal Krishna Gokhale in the beginning, one his political guru, the other his political disciple. Now, Gokhale said to Gandhi that the Hind Swaraj was nothing but the ravings of a mad mind. This is Gokhale. Jawaharlal Nehru in 1945, Gandhi writes a letter to Jawaharlal on the 5th of October 1945, saying, and he writes this letter in Hindi, talking of relevance. It's a shame that we are talking in English. Everyone can't understand, so let me. So he writes this letter in Hindustani and says, those who don't understand, please just ask me for a gist. Chiranjeev Jawaharlal, kai din se tumko likhne ki soch raha hu, aaj hi likh pa raha hu. Ab Hindustan azad hone ja raha hai, aur tum mere waris ho, to अच्छा हो कि मैं तुम्हें बता दूं कि मेरे सपनों का भारत क्या है और जान लूं कि तुम मुझसे सहमत हो या नहीं. और अगर तुम मुझसे सहमत नहीं हो तो लोगों को जानना चाहिए. जरा इस पर गौर करिए. टॉकिंग ऑफ रेलेवेंस, ही सेइंग इफ यू डोंट एग्री विद व्हाट आई से अबाउट द फ्यूचर ऑफ द फ्यूचर इंडिया, देन द पीपल शुड नो. Which means that Gandhi has a certain understanding of the way the country should be run. Not through the back door, not through the corridors of power, but through open interaction between those who are wielders of power and those who have voted them to power. Now, this is the first relevance which comes to my mind straight away. Then he goes on to say in this letter, मैं जो तुमसे कहने जा रहा हूँ मैं 1908 में हिंद स्वराज में कह चुका हूँ. अब गांधी भूल चुके हैं कि उन्होंने 1908 में नहीं 1909 में हिंद स्वराज लिखा था. और फिर कहते हैं कि मेरे सामने हिंद स्वराज है नहीं और अच्छा है कि नहीं है, क्योंकि मुझे ये सिद्ध नहीं करना है कि मैं जो कह रहा हूँ वो वही है. मैं जो आज कह रहा हूँ वो. अब जरा गौर करिए कि गांधी इस चिट्ठी में नेहरू से कहते हैं हिंद स्वराज, सिंस यू सेड शुड ऑट नॉट टू बी फ्रोजन, हॉस्पिटल्स, रेलवेज, पार्लियामेंट्री सिस्टम, सबको गांधी ने हाउ रेडिकली क्रिटिकल गांधी इज ऑफ ऑल दीज इंस्टीट्यूशंस, हॉस्पिटल, रेलवेज, पार्लियामेंट. In the parliament, he even called prostitute. And that was the only word he wanted to change, but then did not change it. Now, here he says, Azad Hindustan mein bade paimane par bhi cheezein banengi. there will be heavy industries in the country, but these would be decentralized. And then he goes on to say, hospital bhi honge, railen bhi hongi, tar bhi honge, kya hoga, kya nahi hoga, ye batana zaruri nahi hai. Asal cheez samajh lo to sab ho jayega. Now those who say that Gandhi is anti-machine, in 45 he is ready to permit the railways. And this man, let us remember, a journalist pointedly asked him, is it true that you are anti-machine? And he said, anti-machine? And pointing to his body, he said, this is the most intricate machine that God has made. How can I be anti-machine? Now, Gandhi was a great admirer of singer machines, sewing machine, of bicycle. Now, to say that Gandhi is anti-machine is to miss the very spirit of Gandhi's Hind Swaraj. So, he is not anti-science, but he has a point against technology. That machine is not the measure of man. Actually, even man is not the measure of things. ये जो हमारे यहाँ हुआ है वो the way progress was defined in post enlightenment Europe and then all over the world, that man is the measure of all things. Gandhi would not accept that. Men, other beings, including stones, that is nature. Everyone has a place in nature. And everyone must be equally respected. Today we have reached a point, and you know it much better than I can ever hope to know, what we have done to nature. Gandhi made a very fine statement when he said, and all, most of you would be aware of this, nature has enough for everyone's needs, not enough for our greed. Today we have reached a point where the situation is much worse, much more aggravated, because our greed has now been turned into needs. What the basic needs of my childhood were, and what my basic needs today are, there's a world of difference. So if the world is going to multiply its needs like it has done, and still talk of sustainable development, you see, we don't realize that we have one rhetoric and another lifestyle. So Gandhi is relevant even when it comes to the most critical crisis that we are facing today, the environmental crisis. Again, one of the most fundamental problems facing the world today is the problem of violence. Can you possibly talk of a civilized world without solving the problem of violence? Here again Gandhi becomes relevant, and I'll say that like in the context of nature, needs, again Gandhi is saying something fundamental. We have to understand that. For Gandhi, violence is no alternative. Our position with regard to non-violence is that we will accept it pragmatically, not in principle. Gandhi says that not only pragmatically, but even not only morally, but even pragmatically, in terms of a viable alternative, not just a desirable alternative, a viable alternative, he says, violence is not a viable alternative, because violence can only breed violence, it cannot end violence. You will remember that the Second World War, the First World War was fought to save the world for democracy, and the Second World War was fought to end all wars. What the Second World War has done, we all know. So Gandhi is relevant in so many ways. One can keep on multiplying. This. There's not a single problem facing humankind today for which Gandhi does not have an answer, where Gandhi is not relevant. So I would say that only those who live in a fool's paradise would even question this. For me, it is an evident truth that Gandhi is relevant. The point for me is not Gandhi's relevance, but the point is Gandhi's possibility.
Thank you so much. I'd like to make two quick observations. Earlier speaker was mentioning about Gandhiji being pro-machinery, and he mentioned Singer. I do a lot of work in the visual media, so I've collected over a few thousand photographs of Gandhiji. And it's very nice to tell you, sir, that we have a lovely photograph of him with the Singer machine, trying the machine out. We have a photograph of him actually riding the bicycle. We have a photograph of him looking through a microscope, using a telephone, shipping navigation equipment. So he was very curious of what technology and what machine equipment can do, and he's always been pro that. That was one. I'd like to also raise a question over here to both my panelists over here, is we often talk about how Gandhi's writings are relevant in today's day and age. What I'd like to also ask is, how relevant was his life? You know, he said at the end of the day, my life is my message. So for the youth, one part is the writings and, going through his entire collected works. But when we look at his life, the way he adapted to change, the way he transformed himself from different facets of life, I mean, again, going through a visual journey, when we put his photographs down from the first photograph he had when he was 7 years old to the last photograph with Vallabhbhai Patel, just before he was assassinated, you can see a visual transformation taking place over there. So for the youth, is that something that they can learn? Or society in general, can they also learn from that? Is he relevant for that aspect, his qualities? Like, for example, he probably had a gift for fundraising. We haven't heard of anybody else who had that quality of fundraising the way he had.
Well, I think absolutely so. In terms of the messages from life, I think this generation probably has not even seen the film Gandhi, the Attenborough film. And maybe they relate to it through other ways. But the fact of the matter is that any account of his biography comes out with, the human frailties that he went through. That he was not particularly gifted and not particularly brilliant, but he made himself over a period of time. He used his personal experiences to rise above, and also used, he could tap into the civilizational knowledge that India had. And, sometimes this just sage advice of Gokhale to say, don't get into politics until you get to know the country and travel around for a year before you actually decide something. And using that to try and relate to what's happening around and transforming himself, just as sartorial styles in trying to change from, and how he got down to taking up the loincloth. The connect that he was able to make with people was extremely, personal. And that's why I think that carried in many ways. People used to come for his darshan. Very often they wouldn't really hear him, what he was speaking. He was not a great orator like many of the leaders that we have today. But just his sheer ability to translate some universal values in his person and his writings. Even his adversaries, he would have a dialogue with them. If he disagreed, he would say why he would disagree and not remain silent. I think there's so many values of public life that get translated so well and communicated so well through his work. There's still lots of issues. There, one can still debate, as maybe Ramchandra Guha is doing today, on the issues of whether he had a platonic love with Sarla Devi or not, and other kinds of things. But I think there's nothing that's covered. I mean, taking Nirmal Bose along with him on those very tortuous days when India and his, India was facing partition in Noakhali, with, you know, whether he was under great amount of stress. And it's at that time, you know, you have an account from Nirmal Das's My Days with Gandhi, which actually brings out all these dimensions of the humanness of him, and also the ability of the human quality that takes him much beyond. And that was able to, that's an idea that people could relate to a lot. So, undoubtedly so.
We've often said that perseverance was one of his traits. I mean, I don't know how many of us realize that he came back to India in 1915. And it was only in 1947, just before he died, he was able to see, or the reason why he came back. I mean, that's about 32 years. So, so do you have any comment for the youth, specifically relevance of his qualities?
I'd like to go back to your observations about his message on his life. It was a minor, but not minor. There's an almost imperceptible omission in your translation, which is very critical. Gandhi says, Maru Jeevanaj Maru Sandej. Now this Jeevanaj, my life alone. So let us remember, this alone is very important. Maru Jeevanaj Maru Sandej. Now this man, who is ready to have all his writings forgotten, obliterated, but his life remembered. And he had a beautiful simile. He would say, the context would be conversion, but conversion is not only religious conversion, there are all kinds of conversions, including ideological conversions. Gandhi would say, you should be like a rose. Like the fragrance of the rose travels. You don't have to speak. So this fragrance of the rose, your life is the rose which is, and its fragrance will reach out, whether you write about it, whether you speak about it, or you don't. So Maru Jeevanaj, that I think is very important. But at the same time, his writing is also important. And Gandhi, you know, those of you who are literary critics would know what postmodernist turn, the deconstructionist turn in literary criticism has done, the death of the author. They all know what, the important thing is not the author. In any case, who is the author? I have written a book. When you are reading it, you are not just reading what I wanted to convey. You are making sense of my book. So then you are the author, I'm no longer the author. So the death of the author. And here is this man, Gandhi. He says, even after the dissolution of this physical body, I shall not die. I will. And then he says, I will not only continue to live, I'll also continue to grow. And how will he grow? He will grow through through your interpretation of his writings. So this afterlife of Gandhi, which is continuing, so while his life is very important, his message is equally important. And for me, fundraising, of course, he had his own way. He and Madan Mohan Malvi. Gandhi would describe Malvi as the prince of beggars. But Gandhi was perhaps the king of beggars. So there was this king and there was this prince of beggars. But his writing, Gandhi had this remarkable capacity. I think he was a thinker par excellence. This remarkable capacity to go to the root of things. Let us remember something which is taught in every textbook. Gandhi, when he comes to India, he says, the root of British rule is our fear. He's going to the root of the British rule. Well, that is the real foundation of British rule. What is the root of the hold of this market, this invisible market, which controls us? We think governments are governing us. Governments are not governing us. It's the market which is governing us. What is the root of the hold of the market? Fear combined with greed. So, Gandhi has this great ability to go to the root of things, and then he says things aphoristically. Well, the man is full of memorable quotes, quotes which you can never forget, and I'll just give you two. Especially important in our context today, since we are discussing relevance. Dharm ko dharm se hi bachaya ja sakta. He's not giving you long speeches. Now, who is going to tell these Hindutvadis ke wo dharm ko nahi maan rahe? Dharm ko dharm se hi bachaya ja sakta. In another context, in the same context, another place Gandhi says, Hindu dharm ko Hindu hi tabah kar sakte hai. He is saying this in 1947, where we are witness to how Hindu religion, Hindu culture, and Hindu tradition is being destroyed by Hindus. Gandhi, in 47, he says, Main aaj, he's staying at Birla's house. He's gone to Chandni Chowk. If you have any idea of Delhi, it's something like 10 miles or so. And Gandhi says, and look at his concern, his anxieties. In the evening prayer discourse, he says that day, Aaj main Chandni Chowk gaya. मुझे देख के बहुत तकलीफ हुई कि एक मुसलमान रास्ते में नहीं दिखाई पड़ा. Now come to think of it, एक मुसलमान रास्ते में नहीं दिखाई पड़ा. What it means, not only to Delhi, but to India as a country. Is that the kind of India we want to make? You go to Lahore, you go to Peshawar, and you feel so sad. All the advertisements and all these boards are in Urdu. What have they done to Lahore? What have they done to Peshawar? Do we want to convert our cities into a replica of Lahore or Peshawar? And since one of our defense ministers, again relevance, you will remember the defense minister who described Pakistan as Nark, as if he was saying something wonderful, very patriotic. And I was immediately reminded of Gandhi saying in 1947, after with great pain he had accepted partition. We can talk about it some other time. Gandhi says, एक बात समझ ले लो. Earlier he said, मेरे लिए हिंदू और मुसलमान में कोई फर्क नहीं, मेरे लिए हिंदुस्तान और पाकिस्तान में कोई फर्क नहीं, मेरे लिए हिंदू और मुसलमान एक पेड़ की दो शाखें हैं, मैं इस शाख को छोड़ दूँ, उस शाख को छोड़ दूँ, ये मेरे लिए मुमकिन नहीं है. And then he says, एक बात ध्यान में रखना, अगर पाकिस्तान अमृतमय होता है तो हम भी अमृतमय होंगे, और पाकिस्तान नरक बनता है तो हम भी नरक बनेंगे. अब गांधी एक और बात कहा करते थे, मैं इस बात को यहाँ छोड़ता हूँ, तो अक्सर कहा करते थे, अकलमंद को इशारा काफी.
थैंक यू सो मच.
just sharing one last little observation. When I went to Sabarmati Ashram, there are these 10 rules over there where you're supposed to follow if you're in the ashram. I read the 10 rules, and there's Amrut Bhai over there who has, you know, played with Gandhiji when he was 10 years old. And I said, you know, it's very difficult to follow even one of these rules to totality. So he said, I'll tell you a secret. Even Gandhiji couldn't follow all the 10 rules. So what he was trying to tell us is, you know, become like him, try to emulate him, try to eliminate the rules, and that's what's important for the youth. You know, we often say that we are not here to turn everybody into a Gandhian. We are looking for the next Gandhi. Because the next Gandhi is required right now. So we'll take questions.
मिनट कम होते हैं गांधी इवन इन सेवाग्राम नॉट इन दिल्ली इन सेवाग्राम इन हिज आश्रम द कांग्रेस वर्किंग कमेटी इज मीटिंग एंड व्हेन इट्स सन डाउन एंड द डेलिब्रेशंस आर स्टिल गोइंग ऑन गांधी वुड लुक एट मौलाना आजाद And the members of this Congress Working Committee would see Gandhi looking at Maulana Azad. And then, with a twinkle in his eyes, Gandhi was a very naughty man, very mischievous man. With that mischievous smile and spark in his eyes, he would say, Aaj ke liye bahut baatein ho gayi, ab baaki baatein kal karenge. And you know why? Because sundown was the time when Maulana Azad needed his whiskey. I have spent a month and a half at Sabarmati Ashram, and I resolved that during those 90 days, I will not touch my whiskey.
we'll take quick questions.
Yeah. I think we have 3-4 minutes. I want to tell everyone in the audience that Mr. Sudhir Chandra is going to have a plenary talk tomorrow morning on Gandhi, the impossible possibility. And having heard him today, I'm keenly looking forward to it. I would ask you to share this with a lot of your friends, because that session needs to be attended and he needs to be heard tomorrow. Thank you so very much. I have one observation to make about Gandhi. In his 25 years leading up to the independence, in terms of total volume of leadership and statesmanship that we had here, I think mankind has not seen that volume of statesmanship and leadership at one time. And that is because he created those leaders. And in those 25 years, the theoretical base that he gave to this country is what eventually led to the India that we had, and we did not become another Pakistan or something else. I think through his work and his life, he gave that base which made us to become
a liberal democracy,
however dysfunctional we have become now.
We can take one question. Yes, please.
So you alluded to the possibility of Gandhiji. I think Virat closed the talk with the same thing. My question is, what were those conditions of temperature and pressure which gave birth to leaders like Gandhi, which have totally become extinct now? Why is the whole world in a poverty of leadership? I know it's a very broad, sweeping question, but just a comment or two from you would really help.
Now, the advertisement has already made, so I need not advertise my talk tomorrow. But there's something I want to say about this tomorrow. But immediately to that, I would say, I have a different take on this. We believe that Gandhi was followed when he was followed. Gandhi was not followed when we think he was being followed. So that would be the subject of my, or perhaps the subject of my talk tomorrow. Or whatever, who knows?
Look forward.
Just a brief comment on this, then I think the possibility of Gandhi is diminished if we are focusing too much on this leadership attribute that attributes it to a single individual. I'm remembered of a very nice piece by Umar Haq, I think in 2008, where he compares Obama with Gandhi, and the title of it is The Builder's Manifesto. What he's trying to convey is that we have too many leaders, we don't have enough builders. You just take the idea of the ashram. Dharampal, who studied Gandhi quite a bit, says that during the period of the freedom struggle, there were many who possibly did not even meet Gandhi, but ended up setting up their own small ashrams. And there were probably thousands of ashrams across the country. Now, I think that kind of model of institution building, allowing for these thousand leaders, is much more important than the individual Gandhi.